begin the open for discussion and questions, I just want to tell you a last few things. We have been telling you about how our returning to a rural area and our leaving the city and the changes it brought about in our lives. And we talked about plants and trees and changing our lifestyle, our ways of bringing up children and so on. This has had certain effects also on what we do today, and I want to tell you about that very briefly. We don't have too much time to do much planting of trees nowadays. A lot of my life is taken up with the law courts. I decided to do law. I have been a practicing lawyer for the past 20 years, but with one important restriction that I put on my own work, which is that I have been doing only public interest litigation, which means that all the cases that I take up are only for general good, something that will benefit society, and I have restricted it or kept largely environment work. So all the cases, we have an organization called the Goa Foundation, which is run by my husband and we are all part of it. We are trying now to protect these resources like the coastal areas, the forests, the hillsides. We want to save them for future generations because there is a lot of development which is coming into Goa. Many people want to have homes in Goa, large apartments, buildings, hotels, and a lot of the environment is getting sacrificed. And we have certain good laws, but which they have to be implemented. And we have to fight and show the judges in the courts why certain projects will destroy the place, why these need to be kept out, what are the bad effects, and how we can protect the very environment which has brought a lot into our lives. So a lot of time goes on environment work. We also have an organization called the Organic Farming Association of India, which is bringing together farmers who have switched to organic. And the purpose is to bring them so that there is an understanding and a sharing among each other, and so that we can become a lobbying force, lobby with the government for changes. If you remember, I told you a reason why people switch to modernized ways of doing things is because of government subsidies, because government persuades. So therefore, this organization is acting as a lobbying force which will persuade government to promote and to support organic farming so that many people can turn to organic farming. We also run a bookstore, and that bookstore is called the Other India Bookstore. It is a bookstore which is a mail order. You can order from any part of the world. There again, we decided that we will keep books which are not from the West. So there is a restriction. We say we don't want the books which are coming from a part of the world which already has so much access to, which has access to people, to bookstores. We are promoting literature which comes from the NGOs, from the organic sector, from alternative ways of doing things, so that people will be able to read or find out what others are doing, and this is our contribution to help turn others and make them also try and think about the ways they are doing things and bring some change in their lives.
Organic farming, you may have mentioned that with the help of Hadari and Aydin, we organized the tour of more than a dozen farmers from Iran through India to see some of the organic farms. Some of them will come.
توی قسمت قبل در مورد تغییراتی که تو زندگی ما اتفاق افتاد در مورد کشاورزی، پرورش حیوانات مختلف، گیاهان، انواع اقسام مسائل مربوط به کشاورزی و تربیت بچه هامون، مسائل مربوط به یادگیری و این مباحث صحبت کردیم، ولی در کنار همه اونها دو سه تا فعالیت دیگه ای هم هست که الان مشغولش هستیم. یکی این که ایشون خانم گفتن که من شخصا دیگه خیلی فرصت پرورش گل و گیاه و پرداختن به امور کشاورزی و مباحثی که تو قسمت قبلی صحبت کردیم رو ندارم و الان حدود 20 سال هست که عملا به عنوان وکیل دارم فعالیت میکنم و کار حقوقی میکنم و یکی از شرط هایی که خودم برای کار خودم قرار دادم این هست که فقط پرونده هایی رو روش کار میکنم و میپذیرم که مربوط به مسائل عمومی و برای نفع عموم باشه و اکثرا هم مسائل مربوط به محیط زیست هست، حفظ سواحل، حفظ جنگل ها و حفظ این منابع برای نسل های آینده و کلا مسائل مربوط به محیط زیست رو سعی میکنم پرونده های مربوط به اون رو روش کار کنم که توی این کارها هم درگیری و اون یک نوع مبارزه ای هست که با قضات توی پرونده های مختلف داریم که بتونیم روی مسائل اثر بذاریم و آگاهی نسبت به مسئله محیط زیست ایجاد کنیم که اکثر وقت من صرف این میشه. غیر از این یک انجمنی هم به اسم انجمن کشاورزی ارگانیک هند داریم. جمعی هست از کسانی که رو آوردن به این نوع کشاورزی بدون سموم و مواد شیمیایی و سعی میکنیم که از مجموعه این افراد نیروی حاصل بشه که یک نوع لابی و فشاری به اون نظام ها ساختارهای دولتی بتونیم وارد کنیم برای تغییر اون روندهایی که بیشتر به نفع تکنولوژی و کشاورزی جدید هست و میخوایم با این فشارها این جریان حمایت دولتی رو به نفع کشاورزی سنتی تغییر بدیم که البته در ضمن همین کار یک گروهی رو هم از چندی نفر از ایران هم داشتیم که یک توری رو رفتنی قسمت‌های زیادی رو بازدید کردن از تجربیاتی که ما اونجا داشتیم. یک گروهی از ایران هم اومدن و استفاده کردن و در کنار همه اینها یک مجموعه انتشارات و کتاب فروشی هم داریم به اسم Other India Press که به نوعی انتشارات حالا هندوستانی دیگر، هندی دیگر، شاید اینجوری بشه ترجمه کرد و اونجا هم باز یک شرطی که برای خودمون گذاشتیم اینه که کتابهایی رو فقط توی انتشارات و توی فروشگاه خودمون داریم که اولا از منابع غیر غربی هستن تماما و غیر از اون کتابایی هستن که معمولا از طریق انتشارات معمولی و راه‌های رایج سخت هست دسترسی به اونها و چیزهایی که انجیو های مختلف چاپ کردن یا گروه هایی که کمتر این توان رسوندن آثارشون و چاپ شده‌هاشون رو به در سطح وسیع دارن سعی کردیم که اون کتاب ها رو روش کار کنیم تا این رو بتونیم به دست گروه بیشتری از افراد برسونیم. So shall we go to the questions? خب اگر سوالی یا ابراز نظری کامنتی هر بحثی که هست فقط این خانم حکمتی میکروفون رو اگر
Thank you for your good explaining your experiment for us. I want to ask you a question about what we are doing in our experiment in Caspian Sea. We are working on the destroying our environment in Caspian Sea through building construction, and it is ruining our environment totally in that place. As we have conversations with engineers, architects, and the peoples who have who are really stakeholders of construction building, we find out that taking care of environment is something we need to become in these stakeholders' minds and our minds, and learn through life to take care of environment. What we have in that place is that there is a dualities between public interest, environmental interest, and our private interest. What is my question and our group question is how to come to learn taking care of environment through life for peoples who are living in cities, not having the experiment of living in farms with rural areas, which makes you learn through nature and then come to cities and trying to have your opinions through laws, through any social activities that you can follow them in the cities. But my question is how we can learn taking care of environment through our life for people who live in cities, not in rural areas.
ایشون میگن که ما هم حالا نمیدونم ما منظورشون یه گروهی هستیم که داریم در زمینه این ساخت و سازهایی که توی سواحل دریای خزر انجام میشه و اون آسیبهایی که به محیط زیست اونجا میزنه داریم کار میکنیم با کسانی که ساخت و ساز میکنن با مهندسین یا افراد مختلفی که دستن در کار هستن و تاثیرگذار هستن داریم در واقع با اونها کار میکنیم برای تاثیرگذاری روی این امر و یکی از نکاتی که بهش برمیخوریم اونجا اون تضاد و تقابلی هست که بین منافع فردی افراد که وارد اون نوع فعالیت ها میشن ایجاد میشه با منافع جمعی و این تضاد خیلی به چشم میاد و سوال مشخص ایشون این هست که این کاری که انجام دادن ایشون توی فضای روستایی بوده توی اون فضای خاص بوده ولی چطور میشه این آگاهی رو توجه رو و کلن در مورد این مباحث مربوط به محیط زیست از این منظر برای کسانی که توی فضای شهری زندگی میکنن کار کرد و این آگاهی رو چطور میشه در اختیار اونها قرار داد؟
I don't know what solution we can get for cities like Tehran, which are so badly polluted that human beings should not be condemned to live in them. So any recommendations that we can give are very, very limited. Because these, many people try to provide solutions, but if the general environment itself is such, it's very difficult to provide some solutions. What we recommend is, if you can, go out of the city for some period of time. Because you see, the impact on the health of people is something that cannot be calculated in terms of money. What is the damage done to young children who are living in cities like Tehran? And every second breathing the poison and then getting asthma, and cancers, you cannot compare them. It is not possible to subject children to that type of poisoning. See, many people think that food poisoning is the most important thing because you eat some food, you vomit, you die. But actually, if you compare the body takes in things through three sources. One is through the lungs, one is through the intestine and guts, one is through water, and for solid food. The interaction with the body and the environment, with the lungs, is 30 times a minute. 30 times a minute. Calculate how many times a day. Now, the impact with the stomach is only 4 times a week. Morning, afternoon, evening. So 4 times. And it takes time for the poisons to be absorbed by the gut and so on. But this poison is instantaneous because exchange is taking place on a continuous basis. But our education system has brought us to believe that don't worry about air. Air should not be clean or dirty. You don't worry about it. You worry that your food is not contaminated. But more dangerous poison is this. Because with this, if your lungs are damaged, if your children's lungs are damaged, they will curse you for the rest of your life. And therefore, we keep telling people that you must look at cities not as places where creative work can be done, because it's a hostile environment to human beings. So hostile environment is not. After having said this, if you are still condemned to live in a city, what do you do? There you have to build a community with the plants. And if you look at many places around the world now, in many places, communities consisting of buildings, communities in a building or in a neighborhood, they are getting together and they are taking the streets. They are planting vegetables on the streets. They are putting trees. They are planting gardens, vegetable gardens, on the rooftops in in the balconies, in the terraces of buildings. So that introducing once more the greenery, because plants have got a very good ability for taking in poisons. Many plants are very good detoxifiers. So if you can get the assistance of plants back into your environment to deal with these things, that would be a first step. Instead, if you plant only trees, that's good enough, but trees will take 8 to 10 years, and in a polluted environment, they may take longer to grow. But smaller, you know, vegetables, salads, all these things, you get the results within 1 month, 2 months, you get the results. You build also an attitude of caring, means you look after something, and that thing looks after you. Whereas in other cases, the attitude is, I don't need to care, the government looks after me, or the market looks after me. When I want vegetable, I want to buy from the market. When I want this, I want that. But then nobody looks after you. It's all your money part. If you get money, you can go and buy it. But if you can grow things yourself, now Norma is a high court advocate. And for 20 years, she's been arguing before high court judges. But still, every evening she will come and work in the garden. She's not planting rose plants. You can plant rose plants, but we have put pomegranates and mango and also a lot of vegetable plants, tomato plants, salad plants, beans, so that you get a continuous supply until you get it and the children get that type of nutrition. And you know that it is guaranteed. The other thing is whether you can support organic farmers. See, organic farmers, they grow food which is not more chemicals. And one of the things that we grow and we eat in cities is chemical food. In the whole of Iran, all the food is produced with chemicals, either for nutrition or after for pesticides. In India, still a very large amount of food is available without pesticides, without chemicals. But even in my own town of Matsa, where we are, it's a market town, if I buy any vegetable from the market, I know that it will have chemicals. So what we have to do is we have to support organic farmers who are growing safe food and give them an opportunity to come into our communities and sell whatever they have, because by buying from them, we help them to do more organic farming. And so in India also, you have many organic farmers who as a group get together and they hire a vehicle and they take all the to the nearest town, to Chennai or Bangalore or to Mumbai or whatever it is. They have a support with a building which has got many flats, and they ask their permission. They come into the building premises and they sell all their organic produce directly to the housewife so that they have safe food. So these linkages have to be built up. The organic farming movement in Iran is building itself in stages. Right now they are doing integrated pest management. That is, they use pesticide only when necessary. But in India we have shown them how you can grow without using pesticides. You may use chemicals, but stop using pesticides. Because the combination of poison and food is only a modern invention. Nobody in all of human history would have allowed poison and food to go together. But modern science has tricked us into saying there's no problem. Even if there is some pesticide, it's not, when you say pesticide kills, how can something which kills be in something which is giving you nourishment? Either food nourishes you or it kills you. In the old times when you wanted to kill somebody, we would put poison in the food. Now all the farmers are feeding poison to everybody. And you are victims, because you don't know. The food is coming from 500 kilometers. You don't know the farmer. You do not know how many times it's putting pesticide. And so you buy it, you eat it, and then you have all sorts of medical problems and cancers, and you don't know. So build up again relationships. Jose Nandari and many of those organic farmers buy their rice so that they have an incentive to grow more rice and more fruits and so on, and safeguard your health. I think these are only two solutions I can afford to people in Tehran. that is make a link with the organic farmers, and number two, try and transform all your neighborhoods and every available terrace into a medium for growing all types of vegetables and plants. Thank you.
البته برای یه جایی مثل تهران میگن که راه اولین چیزی که باید بگم خلاصش اینه که من نمیدونم راه حل چیه، ولی با این همه آلودگی و این شرایطی که هست و اگرم بخوایم توصیه یا پیشنهادی هم داشته باشیم خیلی محدود شاید بشه گفت و این خیلی شاید کاربردی نباشه و سخته که یک راه حلی بدیم و شاید هم البته یه بهترین پیشنهاد باشه که کلا از همچین شهری باید رفت باید بیرون رفت. ولی البته باز توضیح میدن که این شرایطی که اینجا هست و اون آلودگی ها و مسمومیت ها معمولا خیلی ها فکر میکنن که آلودگی غذایی خیلی اهمیت داره، در حالی که ما اگر نسبت دفعات ارتباط بدن رو با محیط ببینیم از طریق غذا شاید در هر روز چند وعده معدود ارتباط پیدا میکنه آدم با فضای بیرونه، غذای آب وارد بدن میشه، ولی تنفس رو هر دقیقه چند ده بار مثلا شاید این ارتباط با بیرون برقرار میشه که نسبتش خیلی زیاد هست اگر اینو در ساعت و در 24 ساعت حساب کنیم. اینه که یک فضای خیلی نامناسبی رو ایجاد میکنه توی این شرایط که پیشنهاد دادن و حل این مشکل رو خیلی سخت میکنه، ولی با این حال دو تا پیشنهاد کلی میدن. یکی این که تو خیلی جوامع دیگه جاهای مختلف دنیا هست که توی در سطح محلات و گروهای کوچک وقتی در کنار هم قرار بگیرن سعی میکنن تا حد امکان با اینکه امکان کاشتن درخت‌های بزرگ و فعالیت اینجوری توی محیط شهری نیست، ولی سعی می‌کنن با استفاده از حتی کاشتن سبزیجات یا بوته‌های کوچک در محدوده کوچکی حتی تو خیابون‌ها یا پشت بام‌ها تا یه حدی سعی کنن که اون زندگی گیاهی رو گسترش بدن توی شهر. و این گیاهان این توانایی رو دارن که تا یه حد زیادی اگر این گسترش رو در از نوع همین گیاهان کوچک هم باشن اگر گسترش پیدا کنن در سطح وسیع شاید بتونن تا یک حدی این شرایط رو جبران کنن. و غیر از این اگر این کار خود این فعالیت شروع بشه غیر از اینی که از نظر محیطی و فیزیکی تأثیر داره اون گیاهان کوچک در کنار همین فضاهای سبز کوچک غیر از این که تأثیر داره یک فضایی ایجاد میکنه یک حس و حالی ایجاد میکنه که خود همین نسبت به اون حساس کردن مردم و آگاهی دادنشون هم اثر گذار است، یعنی هم اثر فیزیکی دارن واقعا و هم شاید مهمتر از اون حداقل این حساسیت رو برمی‌انگیزن در سطح محلات و جوامع کوچکتر باشه. دومین راهی که پیشنهاد میکنن اینه که با اینکه این افراد توی شهرهای مثل تهران زندگی میکنن ولی میتونن از کسانی که بیرون و جاهای دیگه کشاورزی ارگانیک میکنن از اونها به شکل‌های مختلف حمایت کنن، اینکه حداقل محصولات اونها رو بخرن که اینا بتونن مستقیم محصولاتشون رو بفروشن و خود همین باعث تقویت زمینه کاری اونها میشه. و مثلا مثالهایی رو گفتن که در بعضی جاهای گروه‌های تولید کننده با مجتمع‌های مسکونی یک روابطی برقرار میکنن و خود تولید کشاورزا مستقیما میرن سراغ اون مجتمع‌های مسکونی و مستقیم به کسانی که تو اون مجتمع‌ها هستن محصولاتشون رو میفروشن. با فعالیت‌های مثل این میشه حمایت کرد از اون نوع فعالیت‌ها که در دراز مدت شاید باعث گسترش اونها بشه و یک اثری داشته باشه حتی توی این شهرها. و البته تأکید میکنن که این وضعیتی که الان هست حداقل توی ایران خیلی از این محصولات با سم یا با کود شیمیایی تولید میشه، حالا کود رو شاید بشه یک جوری تحمل کرد ولی استفاده از سم یا آفتکش‌ها چیز خطرناکیه و این هم خودش از اون به اصطلاح دستاوردها که نمیشه به اون پیامدهای این نوع زندگی مدرن هست که سم و غذا رو در کنار هم قرار میده. در طول تاریخ یعنی قرار بوده اگه کسی کشته بشه سم توی غذاش میریختن ولی الان ما خودمون اونی که قرار محصول غذایی تولید کنه سم رو خودش با اختیار خودش توی اون قرار میده و این هم از محصولات این نوع زندگی مدرن هست. به هر حال در مجموع این دو تا پیشنهاد رو دارن که یکی فعالیت توی محدوده کوچک محلی و دوم حمایت از کسانی که دارن خارج از این فضای شهری کار کشاورزی ارگانیک میکنند.
خواستم که آقای آلوارز بفرمایید که این فعالیتی که توی کوبا انجام دادن به عنوان یه تجربه چقدر موفق بوده که اون کشاورزی سنتی و یا دامداری سنتی رو تو منطقه حفظ کرده باشه. و اینکه خود هندوستان الان چند درصد به صورت سنتی کشاورزیش انجام میشه و تو خود هند چقدر با ایده و نظر اینا موافق هستن، چه کشاورزا چه بخش به اصطلاح حکومتی. سوال دوم اینه که در مورد این تغییرات ژنتیکی که روی بعضی میوه ها و گیاه ها انجام میدن در جهت بهینه شدن یا ازدیادش بدون دخالت کودهای شیمیایی، نظرشون راجع به این چطوره؟
He has two points. One is with your experience in Goa, to what extent was it successful? And were you, do you think you succeeded in preserving the traditional type of farming there? And can you give us a percentage of like the extent to which currently farming is done in the traditional way and in the modern way? And broadly in the country, in India overall, what are the positions in this regard? And what is the actual, agricultural scene? To what extent are the activities done within the modern framework and to what extent in the traditional form? That is one question. Then the second thing is about these genetically modified thing and plants, fruit, and things like that. There's no inclusion of chemical things as such, but the genetic structure has changed. What do you think about this? I mean, do you find it harmful, or do you accept this kind of thing as part of an acceptable organic farming?
India is a very large country, and I think that even the government does not know what is the extent of farming that is taking place in different methods. For example, traditional farming, which is done by a large number of the tribal communities in forest areas and by small peasants and so on. It's about, right now, about 60% of the agriculture, which is rainfed agriculture, which means that there is no water except during the 3-4 months. And therefore, fertilizers cannot really be used. There is irrigated agriculture is there, but it is still, you know, maybe 20-30%. And that's very small compared to the country as a whole. Traditional agriculture, as I said, is related to these groups, and they are very large in numbers. And what has happened is, because of this organic farming movement, all these people who were doing traditional agriculture are now being converted into organic farmers because they are not using chemicals. So they have created a terminology called default organic farming, which they are doing organic farming by default. So since they are not capable, they can't afford, don't have water, they do traditional farming, and we call it organic farming by default. And all that marketing of their produce is under the label of organic produce. The modern agriculture is in a few major areas of the country, like the Punjab, Haryana, eastern, you know, 4 or 5 states in the north, 1 or 2 southern states, where a lot of chemicals have been used and a lot of pesticides have been used. Now, in the case of Punjab, after 50 to 60 years of agricultural revolution using pesticides on a very large scale, now they have begun to do the medical studies and they have found that the largest amount of cancers in the country are to be found only in that region because of the extensive nature of chemicals used. The groundwater has got all chemicals, pesticides, residues from fertilizer and from pesticides. It has become a terrible situation for many farmers. So what is happening is a lot of the organic farming community is now, it's growing. You know, when we started it in the 80s, it was a very small movement. But now a lot of very good chemical farmers have changed over to organic. And they are producing sometimes even better than the organic. But it is still very difficult to find out how many of these farmers are doing it because the government does not have a database on organic at all. So it's very difficult to give you a realistic figure.
And it's even more so in Goa?
No, this is
all states. We have got about 32 states. Goa is the smallest state in India. It's a very small state. It is only about 3,700 square kilometers. The whole of Istanbul is 5,600 square kilometers.
Yeah, and about the genetically modified food?
So genetically modified food, they have introduced it for cotton. And India has been growing genetically modified cotton now for about 6 to 8 years. And finally now the government has come to the conclusion that it is a failure. Means there is no automatic correlation between the use of genetically modified cotton seed and the production of cotton. In the first 2-3 years, there was a lot of production of cotton, but now because of new insects that have come, the secondary insects have become primary insects, the production has come down, and 2 or 3 of the state local governments have begun to file suits for compensation against the big companies because the production was not as promised. But in the introduction of genetically modified food, the first case was BT, the brinjal plant origins. There was a countrywide agitation 2 years ago, as a result of which the government has stopped commercial introduction of any genetically engineered crops, food crops. And there is a moratorium, and all the activists and all the organic farmers and all the NGOs are strictly following the progress of what the government is trying to do in this area, and there is tremendous opposition. So till today, no food crops have been allowed into the country because of the reservation that we have.
میگن البته هند کشور خیلی بزرگ و وسیعی هست و حتی خود دولت هم آماری به اون صورت دقیق در مورد این قضیه نداره، ولی در مجموع بیشتر برداشتشون این است که بیشتر این کشاورزی در یعنی مجموعاً هند رو در نظر بگیرید از طریق همون روش‌های سنتی یا ارگانیک انجام میشه و مثلا خیلی از قبایل هستن که در جاهای دوردست یه نوع کشاورزی بر اساس آب باران انجام میده که حالا شاید همون کشاورزی دیم خودمون هست که 60% کشاورزی اونها بر اساس متکی به آب باران هست و اصلا آبیاری غیر از طریق آب باران ندارن، آبیاری به صورت مصنوعی ندارن و اصلا چون بر اساس آب باران هست نمیشه در اونها از کود استفاده کرد. اینه که اکثریت و اون غلبه تقریبا در همه جا با اون نوع کشاورزی سنتی و ارگانیک هست، غیر از یه چند تا نقطه مشخص مثل پنجاب و جاهای دیگه که کود و سم در حد خیلی زیاد استفاده میشه. و البته پیامده این همین هست که مثلا در پنجاب بعد از حدود 50 سال که کشاورزی مدرن کار شده و بیشترین مصرف کود و سم رو داشته، الان بر اساس مطالعاتی که میکنن بیشترین میزان همین استان پنجاب، ایالت پنجاب، بیشترین میزان بیماری سربالعلاج رو هم داره. از یه جاهای خاصی این وضعیت رو دارن، ولی در مجموع ایشون میگن که غلبه با همون روش‌های سنتی و ارگانیک هست الان به خاطر فعالیتایی که شده. در زمینه غذاها یا کلن کشاورزی با دستکاری ژنتیکی، ایشون البته به صورت کلی صحبت نکردن. در مورد هند میگه کلن این توی قسمت‌های مختلف هم برای مواد غذایی و غلات و میوه ها و هم غیر از اونها کلن فعالیت موفقی نبوده، یعنی چند سالی این تجربه انجام شده و تقریبا این کار اونجا انجام نمیشه توی هند. But do you think these genetically modified things are healthy? I mean, in terms of health?
We don't accept. Organic farmers, we don't accept genetically modified.
و البته میگن ما هم توی کشاورزی ارگانیک این رو به عنوان کشاورزی سالمی نمیدونیم. هرچند مواد شیمیایی به صورت خاص درگیر نیستن، ولی اون نوع عملیاتی که انجام میشه از نظر ژنتیکی ما اون رو کشاورزی سالمی نمیدونیم و جزء کشاورزی ارگانیک در نظر نمیگیریم.
Organic farming. One of the things that the Indian government is actively trying to do, the point is that the companies don't just operate at the bottom level, they also operate at the top level through the government. So the the ordinary farmer in India who is working with rainfed agriculture, he has a small plot of land and he is doing organic farming. But the What the government is trying to do is to destroy that farmer completely and replace him by big farms who will use these automated techniques which will adopt those practices. And one of the manifestations of that is in the cotton farming, because the machinery changed and they had to change the brand of cotton, and that has led to some 150,000 farmer suicides, which is an absolute scandalous state of affairs, and which the government is trying to retrieve by using the wrong calendar.
گفتن که یک مسئله دیگه هم که باید دید اینه که اون شرکت هایی که این محصولات رو تولید میکنن و میفروشن، علاوه بر این که به خود کشاورزا سعی میکنن که این رو بفروشن، یک راه دیگه ای هم برای اعمال این دارن که از طریق اون نظام های دولتی سعی میکنن در اونها اثر گذاری کنن و از بالا به پایین این نظام کشاورزی رو تحت تاثیر قرار بدن. و عملا الان دولت تقریبا میشه گفت که سعی در این داره که نظام سنتی رو از بین ببره، و این نمونهش هم اینه که حالا زمانش رو نگفتن، ولی در اثر این تحولاتی که برای وارد شدن اون تکنولوژی انجام شد. What was the period of these suicides? در طول 10 سال گذشته میگن 150,000 نفر از کشاورزا خودکشی کردن به خاطر این تغییری که تو زندگیشون اعمال شد از طریق ورود این تکنولوژی ها و اون ضررهایی که هم به اونها وارد شد از طریق اون شرکت ها.
در مورد تعامل انسان و طبیعت یه بحث، خب بحث کشاورزی و زراعت، یه بحث هم بهره برداری از گیاهان خودرو، گیاهان دارویی و خب گیاهانی که تو ایران هم مخصوصا خیلی استفاده میشن، گیاهایی مثل کتیرا و اینها. میخوام ببینم در مورد این نوع ارتباط انسان و طبیعت هم تجربه و پروژه‌ای دارن یا بیشتر کار رو موضوع زراعت کشاورزی بوده؟
You talked about cultivating different types of plants, but a related issue may be using indigenous types of plants that grow on themselves. You do not grow them, but you use them for medical purposes or food purposes, whatever. Do you have any experience in this regard? Wild plants or...
There is in India at least a very large group of people who grow now medicinal plants. They only grow medicinal plants, and there are communities and cooperatives which grow traditional medicinal plants for the Ayurvedic system of medicine. And this is a program supported by the government also. They have a list of some 70 to 80 plants which are required for all different problems that people face, like fevers and colds and body ache and diarrhea, all those viruses. And those plants are grown in village communities and then supplied directly to persons so that they can use them. And their expertise is available. There are websites also on it. It's quite common.
And is there a tradition of collecting these from the wild environment or just growing them?
No, the combination, both are there. I mean, most of the people, for example, in India, who suffer from this jaundice, that is this liver problem, contaminated water, they will be using very small plant that grows wild all over India. Nobody uses allopathic medicine for jaundice. They will use only that particular plant, which is fine. Latin name is Palanthus nigri, and it grows widespread and everybody can identify it, and they boil it in water and they use it.
Yes.
That type of knowledge is there in India. But the real people who know about the medicinal plants are the tribal communities. I mean, their knowledge of medicinal plants from the wild is far superior to even those of the botany professors and ecologists. And they are able to, as a matter of fact, 2 years ago, they were able to identify a new plant for malaria only through the work of the Adivasi tribals. And they then recovered that knowledge, they formed a cooperative, and under the knowledge system, patent knowledge system, some of the contribution from the sale of that plant is now going back to that tribal
community. Yes, you want to. Maybe I will tell him this and then. میگن که این استفاده از اون گیاهانی که توی محیط وحشی رشد میکنن مخصوصا برای مقاصد پزشکی انجام میشه، این کار انجام میدن، مخصوصا اون
گروه‌های قبیله‌ای خیلی این کار رو انجام میدن و تخصص خیلی خاصی هم دارن. حتی خیلی از اونا از کسانی که به طور خاص توی زمین‌های دارویی یا گیاه‌شناسی کار میکنن تخصصشون خیلی بیشتر است از استفاده از اینها. این رو انجام میدن. در این حال هم یه گروه‌هایی هستن که در توی اون قسمت قبلی گفتن، اون در توضیح تخصصشون گفتن حتی یکی دو سال پیش گیاهی رو برای درمان مالاریا حتی پیدا کردن که این بعد یه شرکتی تشکیل شد برای استفاده از اون و یه قسمت از منافعش هم به همون قبیله‌ای که این رو پیدا کرده بود برمیگرده. در این حال هم یه گروهایی هستن که علاوه بر استفاده از اون گیاهی که توی محیط طبیعی رشد میکنن، حدود 70 تا 80 نوع گیاه دارویی رو میشناسن و اون رو پرورش میدن، یعنی کشاورزی نه به صورت استفاده از محیط طبیعی، و این کار رو هم انجام میدن.
I wanted to add that a lot of people in the village, the older generation, knows about the plants which are found in the local environment. And they know how to use the leaves. They don't grow them. That was, I thought, your question. They are not cultivating them. They are plants which are growing just normally, like the tulsi and several plants. And they know to pick up the leaves and to make a concoction which you can use if you are ill and so on. Two things which are going against this now is, one is the children are being sent to schools and they are being not familiarized with the environment around them. They go into a school, so there is no way of the elders teaching them about these things, because once you get caught up in school, you are caught up with schoolwork and homework and so on. So that knowledge is not being transmitted. And the second thing is that the government is doing two things. One is because of progress and development, they are setting up pharmacies in all the places. That is a sign of progress, that you have a dispensary, you have a pharmacy, you can buy medicines. And government is also, at least I know in Goa, they are providing a mediclaim insurance for all the people. Now this mediclaim and these insurances will come to you only if you avail of the modern system. The traditional system is out. So with this, I see that this traditional knowledge of how to treat illnesses in a benign way by not going in for the pills is slowly dying out. People are now feeling that the correct system is to go for the allopathic systems of medicine.
میگن نسل قدیمی که تو روستاها هستن طبیعی که با همین گیاهانی که هستن، گیاهان دارویی که به صورت خود رو هم هستن، آشنان، میدونن که چه ترکیبی از کدوم ها رو استفاده کنن برای چه مصارفی. ولی دو تا نکته داره اتفاق میفته که این امر رو مشکل میکنه. یکی این که نسل جدیدتر، بچه ها معمولا الان دیگه وقتشون رو بیشتر توی مدرسه صرف میکنن، برای همین اصلا اون فرصت و فضایی که وجود داشته به صورت سنتی برای آشنایی با این گیاها دیگه از بین رفته و اینها دیگه نمیشناسن اون رو. این یک. دوم این که توی اون فعالیت های توسعه دولت، یکی از نشانه های پیشرفت هر منطقه این هست که دارن تو هر منطقه داروخانه ایجاد میکنن و وقتی اون ایجاد میشه کلن تکیه کسانی که اونجا هستن به این نوع داروها بیشتر میشه و خود به خود ارتباطشون با اون نوع سنتی قطع میشه.
اقدامات های آلوارز و سرکار خانم نورما توی حوزه های فعالیتشون قابل تحسین و قابل تشکر، اما به نظر میرسه مشکل جای دیگه است. ما یه حوزه تقریبا جریان مسلطی داریم که مقابل جریانی هستن که آقای آلوارز و خانم نورما بهش متعلقن، در حقیقت جریانی که تو حوزه مصرف حداقل تکیه میکنه بر الگوهای مصرف بیشتر و از طرف دیگه با تغییر الگوهای مصرف و ذائقه‌های مصرف مصرف کنندگان، این جمعیت‌ها رو تشویق میکنن به سمت مصرف بیشتر. شما این رویکرد مسلط هم به اون جریانه که تقریبا الگوهای مصرف دستشونه و تعریف میکنن و در حقیقت بیس اون پایه اصلی اون جریان هم مصرف بیشتره. اون جریان زمانی که شما مواجه میشید با جریان کیلومترها جلوست، یعنی اقدامات آقای آلوارز و خانم نورما در حقیقت شبیه کسی میمونه که در حقیقت مسابقه بین یه موتور آبی که مثلا 8 اینچ آب داره به یه استخر تزریق میکنه و از طرف دیگه دو نفر هستن که اون مشت دارن آب میزن توی استخر دیگه. به نظر میسه ریشه اصلی مشکلات ما تو این حوزه است که اون گرانیگاه نگاه باید تغییر بکنه. یعنی شما تا اون گرانیگاه رو تغییر ندی، اقداماتی که ایشون داره و سایر حوزه‌های دیگه، همه ما هم جمع بشیم کمک ایشون، مطمئنا تو مواجهه با اون جریان شکست خواهیم خورد. به نظر میرسه اون گرانیگاه اگه عوض بشه خیلی از اقداماتی که ایشون داره انجام میده و سایر ایاله بزرگوارانی که چند تاشون تو ایران هستن یعنی آشناشون باشون لازمش اینه برای موفقیت این نگاه اون گرانیگاه تغییر بکنه اون گرانیگاه اگه تغییر بکنه بعد دیگه کار بزرگواران و سایر ایاله همکاران دوستانشون خیلی راحت میشه میخواستم نظرشون رو بپرسم پیرامون این نکته و راهکارشون برای تغییر گرانیگاه چیه
البته در مورد خودشون که چون بحث‌های دیگه کتاب فروشی و انتشارات و مالتیورسیتی و بحث‌های حقوقی و اینها رو در نظر بگیریم فکر کنم شاید در مورد خودشون نمیدونم چقدر صادق هست ولی his question is what you are doing is quite admirable and interesting I mean this is it is I mean we admire that but the point is this is a small stream in a particular direction And the dominant stream, a very big one, in the opposite direction, is moving in terms of quality, quantity, whatever, much, much more forcefully. So the point, and it is based on consumption, more and more consumption, relying on that called modern structures and constructs, things like that. Don't you think that we should, if we change the locus and the focus of our attention to some other point, which it does not specify, then, and if we solve broader issues of mentalities and perspectives, we would solve these issues in more fundamental terms. I mean, should we change the location to some other point? Should we focus on some other point, or should we go on with these very local, small activities? Of course, I told him about your other activities, including the books and the legal activities that could be part of it.
Yeah, so today we have come to speak only about the experience of bringing nature back into our ways of thinking. We have not come to talk about any other issue. But I agree with him that you can stop a factory from coming up, you can stop a school from coming up. But if you don't deal with the thinking that leads to the factory and to the school, then they will keep coming up like mushrooms in different places. And that is why in the Multiversity project, we try to deal with that issue. We dealt with it in the morning. We are dealing with it in a different way from the angle of the food and the land and agriculture and the natural environment. There are certain things I think there is sometimes we feel that we are in a blurry. I don't think that is true. If you look at the environment discussion, you know, maybe 25, 30 years ago, Rachel Carson and a few other people were in the minority. When Rachel Carson produced her first book, Silent Spring, she was attacked by all the people there. She was attacked by the chemical industry, by those people who were producing DDT. They attacked her research and did it all sorts of things. But today nobody will say that the world is in the same situation. I mean, if you look at the entire climate change debate, the discussions that are going on to reduce the emissions into the atmosphere, maybe we have not succeeded there, but then the governments have failed. We have put pressure, but the governments have failed. There is today a unilateral consensus among all the nations of the world that we have exceeded our environmental limits. That out of, you know, the 30 natural ecosystems, about 27 are in decline, which means they are not being regenerated. They are in the state of steady degeneration. Thousands of scientists, more than 2,000 scientists, have generated the climate change report. Previously we could not even get 5 scientists to do it, but now there are more than 2,500. So there is an enormous, it's not leading to direct practical changes. But if you look at organic farming itself, the government of India now says that we have to change over to organic farming. There are 5 states in India which have converted to organic farming. I mean, you take the state of Mizoram, the state of Uttarakhand, Kerala, they have said that we are becoming completely organic states. We are banning GMOs completely from the state. Even in India, we are banning. So there is a safe food movement all over. People want, they say that we have got money to buy the latest mobile phones. But we have money, but we can't get safe food. Even if you have got money, in Tehran city, you cannot get food which is not contaminated with pesticides. Yeah. More and more people are demanding. And that is a sign of change. And I think that maybe in a few years from now, this will become mainstream. That's what we are in any case. All of us in this audience and among Multiversity, CISSC, and many other organizations, we are all committed to this type of change.
Yes, after this maybe. ایشون میگن البته ما امروز الان تو این جلسه قرار بود که مشخصا در مورد اون بحث طبیعت صحبت کنیم و این فعالیتایی که تو این هیته خاص بود، برای همین هست که به چیزهای دیگه نپرداختیم. و ولی اگر بخوایم سایر جنبه‌هاش هم در نظر بگیریم، این مشخصه که ما اگر یه کارخونه رو مثلا تعطیل کنیم یا یه مدرسه ای رو ببندیم ولی اون ذهنیت همچنان سر جاش باشه و اون نپرداخته باشیم، خب مثل قارچ دوباره رشد میکنه. و برای همین هم هست که ما اون فعالیت های دیگر رو مثل مالتیورسیتی، فعالیت هایی که جای دیگه داریم انجام میدیم رو در کنار این داریم کار میکنیم روش، با هدف همون تأثیر گذاری روی ذهن که اونها سر جای خودش هست. ولی در این حال این هم میتونه یکی از اجزاء اون نوع فعالیت عام باشه. و مثلا شما اگه بحث محیط زیست رو ببینید 35 سال پیش، شاید یه تعداد خیلی کمی در اقلیتی اصلا در مورد این قضیه بحث میکردن، ولی الان حداقل اینه که این بحث فراگیری شده که بهش میپردازن و تقریبا دیگه همه جای دنیا پذیرفتن که از نظر محیط زیستی این به یه حد اضطراری رسیدیم. و اگرچه ممکنه تغییر مستقیم عملی خیلی در سطح محدود ایجاد نکنه، ولی در طول زمان اگر ببینیم این میتونه یکی از اون مجموعه فعالیت ها باشه. و مثلا حتی توی هند هم با همه این شرایطی که گفتن وضعیت دولت هند داره، حداقل 5 تا دولت محلی اون به اصطلاح ایالت ها هستن که دولت ایالتی اعلام کرده که روش غالبشون، یعنی اون چیزی که مورد حمایت دولت هست، همین کشاورزی ارگانیک هست. به هر حال اینکه میگن در این حالی که حرف شما درسته که اون کلیت و ذهن رو باید دید، کارهای دیگه ای برای اون بحث ذهن داریم از جمله در قالب بحث مالتیورسیتی انجام میدیم، ولی خود همین هم میتونه در دراز مدت یک بخشی از اون کار روی ذهن باشه.
یه سوالم راجع به طبیعت نیست، راجع به زندگیه. امیدونم یکی از رویاهای من شاید همسرم برگشت مهاجرت به روستاست مثل زوج آلوارز. حالا نمیدونم مثلا اگر شما الان جوان بودید تو این زمان اگر میخواستید روستا برگردید، اینترنت و وسایل ارتباط جمعی هم جزو اون چیزا بود که ترک میکردید؟ چون بر اساس گفته‌های آقای فاشه و شما بیشتر این علمی که دارید از اطرافیانه، از کسایی که باشون زندگی کردید، نه از دانشگاه اینا. اگر برگردید دوباره همین زمان به روستا، آیا وسایل ارتباط جمعی هم میذارید کنار؟ سوال دوم هم در مورد خانواده هاست. شاید یه مشکل ما جوان ها مخصوصا ایران خانواده هاست. شما با خانواده هاتون اون موقع چیکار کردید؟
She said one of my dreams is to my dreams and one of the dreams of my husband. I know how big the dreams of her husband are. Maybe bigger than the dreams you had. Is to leave the city and go to a village, maybe. But the point is, how about this new technologies we are, like our life is entangled with? Like, would you take internet to that village if you were to move now as a young couple to a village, or things like that? That is one thing. And then about the families, what did you do with your families when you left the city?
I think the hardest step is the first step. To decide to change something and go someplace else, to make that first move is hard, because you leave behind things that you are familiar with, a secure place, what you know about, and making that first decision is the hardest. I know that, for example, when we left Bombay and went to Goa, my college where I was teaching, I was a lecturer in history, my college, they told me that, look, it might not work there and they gave me a 2-year lien on my job. They said, you can come back for 2 years, we hold your job for you. Because people don't think it will work, and in a certain sense you are also afraid. So I said, all right, I'll keep my 2-year job. So I think that first step is the hardest step. And somebody at the tea time was asking me that I also want to change and go elsewhere. I want to do something else. But I feel I must become stronger and more confident, and then I can have the courage and I will go. And I said to her that the longer you delay, the worse it becomes. Because the more you stay in what you are entangled in it and you cannot come out of it. So I think one of the things that as you get educated, the more educated you are, you become less courage. You have less courage to do things because the education takes you out of the world, puts you in a classroom, closes the windows and says you learn here. And then you get more tied down to that. And if you are made free, you don't want to be free, you want to run back. So the change has to be made as a swift decision. You have to decide, and whatever skills you have, you have to be confident that it will work in a changed environment. About things like internet and so on, I think these are tools. I like to think that you try to reduce dependence on these kind of technological things. For example, air conditioning. There are people who say we cannot do without air conditioning, it's so hot. But I think you have to learn to live with nature and in nature, and having access to certain things at some times is not a bad deal at all. But you have to free your mind of total and complete dependence on these kind of technical things. If tomorrow my phone doesn't work, I don't mind. If tomorrow the lights do not work, I don't mind. Because even when our children were young, I remember that when the lights would, sometimes the power would go and the lights would go. And we had their cousins who had come from the city and they said, oh, it's gone so dark. And my youngest son who was there said, no, it's not dark. See, there's the moon. There is light today. Some days there is no moon and it's very dark. But today is not a dark day. And they used to enjoy the days when the lights went out, because we would go to the balcony and sit down and I would tell them stories. So there are positive things to be seen. There are positive things to be seen in everything. If you see the lights going off as a disaster, then it is a disaster. But if you see it as an occasion to do something else, to go for a stroll, to do something else, then it is enjoyable. At some time, the children would actually wait for the lights to go out because they would think this is now story time and parents are sitting with them. About relatives that you asked, well, we are never far away from relatives. In some sense, it was nice to be away because they tell you what to do and then you have to explain all the time. But you can visit and you don't have pressures of family asking you too many questions, and you can answer something and then you go away and then they don't ask you again for some time. So it helps in the end. But I think it's really that decision. I think there is no preparation that you can make for it. You cannot plan for it. It just has to happen.
Okay, so is this the case just with the husband's family or with your own family too?
Both families. But we still live in a village. I mean, we have lived in a village from 1976 till today. We are living in a village, but now because of these things we can get internet. I don't know about Iranian villages, but Indian villages now you can get internet. There's no problem at all.
The same
here, phones and all that. But what is very interesting, what we find very nice, is that our colleagues are not university professors, and our colleagues are very simple individuals, people who grow rice, people who are doing masonry work, people who whitewash the house, and people who remove the coconuts and so on. And they don't know what a PhD is. And I'm the only PhD in the village. But it doesn't make a damn difference to anybody. Because we are all equals, we all talk, they talk, their children come to our house, our children go there. So it's a very, very humane environment to deal with.
in that sense. And that we find very remarkable.
Okay. البته ایشون میگن قدم سخت همون اولین قدمه و خلاصش اینه که میگن باید تصمیم یک دفعه بگیرید، بخواید فکر کنید و بهش بپردازید، هر چی بیشتر فکر کنید و کلن هم میگن هر چی بیشتر درس بخونید و با مدرسه و دانشگاه و این فضا بیشتر سر کار داشته باشید، اون تصمیم دفعی رو گرفتن سخت‌تر میشه. و خیلی حالا برداشت من اینه که با حساب کتاب خیلی نمیشه تصمیم گرفت. اگر قرار تصمیم گرفته بشه باید یک دفعه تصمیم بگیرید و اون قدم اولو که بردارین بقیه دیگه حل میشه. میگن خود من وقتی میخواستم برم، من قبلش توی یه دانشکده تدریس میکردم و اونجا کار داشتم و وقتی گفتم به من گفتن که احتمالاً این جواب نمیده و ما برای همینم تا دو سال این فرصت رو بهت میدیم که اگر خواستید برگردین به کارتون برگردید. ولی به هر حال ما اینو بر کردیم رفتیم و خلاصه اینکه این تصمیم رو دفعی باید گرفت و این تأمل بیش از حد و مخصوصا توی فضای دانشگاه و مدرسه بودن بیش از حد هی جرأت آدم رو کمتر و کمتر میکنه. بعد در مورد اینترنت و چیزای شبیه این، ایشون آخرش توضیح دادن که ما همین الانش هم داریم تو روستا زندگی میکنیم، اینترنت هم داریم، از این وسایل هم استفاده میکنیم، خیلی مسئله خاصی نیست. ولی توضیح ایشون این بود که بحث وابستگی به اون هست که چقدر وابسته هستی به اون. اگر مثلا به کولر و وسایل تهویه هوا و این ها اگر خیلی وابسته باشیم، اون وقت اصلا یادمون که بره که با جریان طبیعی زندگی گرما و سرماش میشه زندگی کرد، این خوب نیست. اگر اون موقعی مثلا خط تلفن قطع باشه یا برق نباشه، اگه این فاجعه به حساب بیاد، این بد هست. و میگن که موقعی بچهای ما که کوچیک بودن، اون دوستانشون یا حالا پسرمون دخترمون کازنز کلن می اومدن از شهر، وقتی برق میرفت یه دفعه انگار یک فاجعه بود براشون، ولی بچه‌ها مون میگفتن خب حالا برق رفته ما هست. خیلی یعنی وابستگی به اون اگر زیاد نباشه، استفاده کردن یا نکردنش خیلی مسئله حاد و مرکزی نیست. در مورد خانواده ها میشون میگن که همین که البته من که ما خیلی دور نبودیم و غیر از اونم همین دوری کم هم شاید بد هم نبود که خیلی دخالت نکنن تو کارهای آدمو و ما بتونیم خودمون باشیم. البته من پرسیدم در مورد خانواده ایشون فقط، در مورد خانواده شما هم همین رو میگید؟ گفتن خانواده من بدتر بودن.
خب خسته نباشین، دستتون درد نکنه. دوستانی که امروز صبح تشریف آوردن اینجا، مجبور شدن بعضیا برن، در هر صورت از همه ممنون. از آقای دکتر دوستانم تشکر میکنیم، خیلی زحمت میکشن، و سرکار خانم دکتر قهرمانی، سرکار خانم دکتر سازور، همه خیلی لطف کردن، زحمت کشیدن. روز چهارشنبه و پنجشنبه رو لطفا فراموش نکنین، خودتون تشریف بیارین، به دوستانتون بگین. از آقای سمسارم خیلی تشکر میکنیم، زحمت هماهنگی همه سالن و بقیه چیزها رو داشتن. به دوستانتون بگین و به دوستان دوستانتون هم بگین که تشریف بیارن. حرفهای خیلی زیادی زده شد ولی حرفهای خیلی زیادی هم موند. به قول قیصر امینپور، حرفهای ما هنوز ناتمام، تا نگاه میکنی وقت رفتن است. باز هم همان حکایت همیشگی، پیش از آن که با خبر شوی لحظه عزیمت تو ناگزیر میشود. آه ناگهان چقدر دور، چقدر زود دیر میشود. همه رو به خدای بزرگ میسپارم. انشالله چهارشنبه و پنجشنبه منتظرتون هستیم. Thank you.